Welcome back to Crack the Cure series with me, Kavya Tendral. Today we'll see an important test called the Turing Fork test, and this is the first part, that is the Rini's test, logical reasoning out and tricks in remembering this Rini's test. If you have not subscribed our channel, do subscribe for more interesting videos like this, and as well press the bell icon so that you will receive a daily video notification. Before we actually go to the test per se, we'll see the parts of Turing Fork to make it more easier. The prong, stem and the footplate. Prong is actually the vibrating part so that we can align it along the EAC, and the stem we can hold it the tuning fork, especially this part of the stem we can hold it through the tuning fork, and then the foot plate we can place it over the bone based on the test, that is the Rini's or Weber. The place varies, but then the place of the tuning fork which is placed on the surface is same, that is the foot plate. Next, coming to the types of tuning fork, basically we have different types of tuning fork starting with 128. The other frequencies are varying at a number of 2, so if you multiply into 2, all the numbers we can derive. The most commonly used is 512 hertz. How to activate it or to vibrate the tuning fork is just simply take it, strike against the elbow here of the hand or even the rubber here of the shoe so that it starts vibrating up. Next, we see the very important general consideration. One, if we take low hertz tuning fork, that is 128 and 256, that gives a sense of bone vibration, whereas in high frequency tuning fork, it vibrates and decays in a shorter period of time. Then coming to air conduction, is always greater or twice longer greater than the bone conduction. Now, air conduction is still the pinna to footplate of stapes, and after that it is bone conduction. Ultimately, what is happening is there is stimulation of the cochlea and the cochlear part of the eighth nerve, that is the vestibulocochlear nerve. This stimulation of the nerve can be by vibration of the bony cochlea via the tympanic membrane vibration, bony vibration of the mastoid, and can also be from the transcranial through the conduction by the cranial bones. Next, coming to the test per se, Rini's test. We have Rini, that is from this we can infer there is air and bone. It is comparing the air conduction with bone conduction. We can also infer the air-bone gap. Next, how is the procedure? Is just take the tuning fork, activate the tuning fork first, place on the mastoid, and the moment the person cannot feel the vibration, take it towards the EAC, align it parallel to it, at least 1 to 2 centimeters away from the EAC, do it. If at all the person is hearing, then that is positive. If the person is not hearing the vibration, then it is Rini's negative. Rini's positive is the air conduction is better than the bone conduction. We say the air conduction is better. It means the bone conduction we are not speaking about. The bone conduction pathology is sensory neural, and thereby in Rini's test we are considering normal and as well sensory neural hearing loss as Rini's positive. Rini's negative is bone conduction is better than air conduction. So Rini's negative is conductive hearing loss. If at all there is a negative Rini's test, there will be always an air-bone gap of minimum 15 to 20 decibel to be noted. Now let us see an easy thing to remember, how to predict the air-bone gap using a simple formula. And these are the tuning forks we will be using, 256 Hz, 512 Hz and 1024 Hz. And we know the minimum air-bone gap will be 15 decibel. So just add, as these 256, 512, 1024 are varying at a number of into 2, the same series or sequence is getting added up by adding 15 to this 15. So 256 is somewhere 30, and then add 15, 512 is negative, it means there is 45 decibel airborne gap. 1024 also is negative, then that be 60 decibel airborne gap. This is what is emphasized there. Rather, this is a formula, this is basically just a trick. The same is what emphasized here. 256 is negative and 512 is positive, then there could be 20 to 30 decibel airborne gap. 256 and 512 is negative, whereas 1024 is positive, 30 to 45 decibel airborne gap. All three are negative tuning forks, then there could be 45 to 60 decibel of airborne gap. If at all a component of a false negative Rini's test comes, what that is mean is the Rini's test is negative, but the inference what we get, that is the bone conduction is greater or better than the air conduction, it is the inference basically, that is the false. So false negative indicates the inference which we get from the negative Rini's test is false. That is, we usually infer bone conduction better than air conduction in Rini's is conductive hearing loss. But here there could be a unilateral severe sensorineural hearing loss. This can be possible by transcranial transmission of vibration to the opposite ear. This can be further evaluated through other tuning fork test and the audiometry test. So false negative Reinisch test is holding good with severe unilateral sensorineural hearing loss. To summarize, Reinisch test positive, it means air conduction is better than bone conduction. It could be normal or sensorineural hearing loss. Negative, it sends bone conduction is better than air conduction, that is conductive neural hearing loss. In any conductive hearing loss, there can be air bone gap, minimum 15 to 20 decibel. There can be another possible of false negative test, wherein which bone conduction is still better than air conduction, but then because of transcranial transmission, this happening. This is in case of unilateral severe sensorineural hearing loss. In case of this false negative, we can also use Baranese noise box to check it out, but rather than, we can go for other VBUS test and other audiometry test to confirm. Thank you so much for your patient listening.